Prince Park Church. There's only a few announcements. This is the last day for the clothing drive, and so I'm sure if you have anything even this afternoon, if you want to bring it over, that would be great. There is a worship and music meeting next Sunday, and I believe there's an announcement about the VBS meeting today.
Yes, the VBS meeting is getting moved until the end of April, so April the 24th, I believe.
Okay, so the meeting for the VBS people will be at the end of April. Okay, would you please rise? Christ Jesus came to our world to save sinners. He bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good.
Christ lived for us. Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ now reigns in power for us. This is why we come to praise him.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of this day, knowing that each day is a gift from you. Please help us this day. Give us eyes to see how you are at work in every moment and every circumstance. Lord, give us perseverance to increase our understanding of you. Give us a hunger to read your word, to seek to know you more each day. Just as the dawn comes each morning, help us to trust that you will also move in our lives in your perfect timing and in your gracious way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins together.
Gracious God, in order that we, with your children, might discern good from evil, you sent your Son to be the light of the world. As Christ shines upon us, may we learn what pleases you, and live in all truth and goodness. Hear our humble prayers as we repent of our sin and renew within us a knowledge of your unfailing love.
In Jesus' name, amen. By grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ that we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Let us sing together our first hymn.
Thank you.
sovereignty as the eternal, immutable, and almighty God, and gives being to all his words and works. Our one true God is the God of the covenant with Israel, and now with all people. This is the same one true God who brought the Israelites out of bondage and delivered us from our spiritual captivity. And we are bound to take this same God as our God alone and to keep all God's commandments.
Amen. You may be seated.
This morning to join me as we lift up our voices using words of scripture found in Psalm 32. Blessed is he whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against him, and whose spirit there is no deceit. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord. This morning, as we continue reading through the book of Exodus, I invite you to acknowledge that I am continuing to abridge the scripture. So if you try to read along in a few minutes, you might be surprised that it's not exactly what's in your Bible, since I did edit out some of the verses in between to allow us to have enough time this morning to read all of Exodus chapters 19 and 20. Before we do, please join me in prayer. Creator God, we thank you that in this Lenten season, this time of preparation, you have invited us to return to scripture, to words written long ago about a people a long time ago. And Lord, even though the individuals in this account lived a long time ago and feel so distant in a faraway land, a different culture, a different language, a different time, and a different context, we understand, Lord, that your word is true for all people across all time and place. And we understand that your word is truth. So as we read your word today, discover your commands for your people, and try our best to live into the way you desire for us. Guide us to have hearts that are open to obedience. Allow us through this powerful presence of your Holy Spirit to hear you speak. And guide us, Lord, to better understand what it means to be followers of the one true God today, in the place and time and context and situation you have called each one of us. For Lord, we know each one of us is your beloved creation, equipped and prepared for whatever you call us to do, to say, and how you lead us to respond. Guide us now as we open your word to hear it proclaimed and to respond in ways that bring glory to you. We ask this all in the name of Christ. Amen. So this morning we are going to look at Exodus chapters 19 and 20. If you've been following along with me through the season of Lent, we are now at the exact halfway point of the book of Exodus, so 40 chapters, so we're going to get to chapter 20 today. I've been preaching on Exodus and also offering a video Bible study weekly. So if you'd like to follow up, you can look on our Facebook, our church website, or on our church YouTube to kind of catch up on the lessons in between. I also encourage you as a devotional practice this Lent to read through the entirety of Exodus, acknowledging that I am skipping over some portions as we go through our time of study. So hear these words today in Exodus chapters 19 and 20. On the first day of the third month, after the Israelites left Egypt, they came to the desert of Sinai, and Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "This is what you are to say to the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did in Egypt, and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation." So Moses went back and summoned the elders of the people and set before them all the words the Lord had commanded him to speak. And the people all responded together, "We will do everything the Lord has said." So Moses brought their answer back to the Lord. The Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to come to you in a dense cloud, so the people will hear me speaking with you, and they will always put their trust in you. Go to the people and consecrate them. Have them wash their clothes and get ready, because the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. Put limits on the people around the mountain and tell them, 'Be careful that you do not approach the mountain or touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain is to be put to death. They are to be stoned or shot with arrows. Not a hand is to be laid on them. Only when the ram's horn sounds a long blast may they then approach the mountain.'" After Moses had gone down the mountain to the people, he consecrated them, and they washed their clothes. Then he said to the people, "Prepare yourselves. On the morning of the third day, there was thunder and lightning, with a thick cloud over the mountain, and a very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the holy mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord had descended on it with fire. The smoke billowed up from it like smoke from a furnace, and the whole mountain trembled violently. As the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him. God spoke all of these words: 'I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt and out of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth below, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for their sin of their parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and mother, so that you may live long in the land your God is giving to you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his servant or anything that belongs to your neighbor." When the people saw this, they heard the thunder and saw the lightning. They heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke. They all trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself and we will listen, but do not have God speak to us or we will die." Moses said to his people, "Do not be afraid. God has come to test you, so the fear of God will be with you and keep you from sinning." The people remained at a distance, while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Tell the Israelites this. You have seen for yourself that I have spoken to you from heaven. Do not make any gods to be alongside me. Do not make for yourself gods of silver or gods of gold. Instead, make an altar of earth for me and sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and your fellowship offerings. Wherever I cause my name to be honored, I will come to you and I will bless you." So often when we think of the Ten Commandments, we may think back to a time in Sunday school or vacation Bible school or earlier in our life when we probably learned the Ten Commandments off a big laminated poster on the wall, where it was just number 1, 2, 3, all the way through 10. And oftentimes young Christians are asked to memorize these Ten Commandments. When we read about the Ten Commandments, though, in context in Scripture, we discover they weren't necessarily delivered in that way. It's like a bullet-pointed list for people to memorize and write down. As we've been journeying with these people through the Exodus, with their Israelite faith ancestors, we've gotten to a place now where they have been tested multiple times, where they have witnessed miraculous signs and wonders over and over again, and where we've discovered, especially most recently, how despite plagues and these changes to the natural world, despite the parting of the Red Sea, and all that has happened to them, miraculous feeding, manna and quail and water being given to them, they've still been these grumbly, kind of complaining, infantile people that God's had to work to mold under the direction of Moses and Aaron and Hur and Miriam and these other leaders, Joshua, that have been risen up above them. And now, surprisingly, we do this preparation for receiving these commands from God, and the back and forth between Moses and the people does not include grumbling anymore. The people are now 1 month beyond the place where they were last reported grumbling. It's been about 30 days. And it appears that they're behaving better. It appears that they have accepted their role as the people of God, that they're understanding better Moses' role as intermediary between God's word and the people. And they appear to be a bit more cooperative. So as Moses brings this message from God to the people, that God has something important to say to you, that this is a holy place, a place in the wilderness, not the place we came from in Egypt, and not the place we're going to, this promised land, but some kind of no man's land in between. It's here that God's going to meet us and offer us some instruction. And Moses says to the people, in order to receive this instruction, this word from God, there are some rules God's put. God's going to speak to us from the top of a mountain, and God's going to speak to you through signs and wonders, through lightning, through thunder, through a dark cloud, through fire, through the trembling of the earth, and through the broadcast noise that you're going to hear through this ram's horn kind of sound. And all of that is to show you the amazing power of God. But in order for God to then speak to you, you have to get ready for that. So Moses sets up some boundaries. The first rule is you can't actually go up the mountain. When God's on the mountain doing all of this natural phenomenon that's overwhelming, don't try to run up into the cloud or into the earthquake or into the fire. Stay a distance. Because it's not that necessarily it's inappropriate to be close to God, but God is so overwhelming and the mighty, powerful presence of God is overwhelming, you will die if you get too close to God. So you have to stay at the bottom of the mountain. And then Moses says, in addition to staying at a safe distance when God speaks to us, you have to get yourself ready. And the word they use in the English translation is to consecrate yourself or to make yourself holy. In the Hebrew, the word to make yourself holy is the same word you would use when you're going to say, I'm going to set something apart. So I often think, and I try my best to follow recipes, but I'm not very good at it. But often I discover when you bake, they'll say, like, set apart 2/3 of the flour from 1/3, and then later you'll mix it together differently. I never do that correctly. But there's this kind of understanding of setting apart a portion because it will be better if it's set apart. If you wait and follow the directions properly, you'll end up with a more successful outcome whenever you're baking. So here, there's this kind of preparation that says we need to set you apart. There's a boundary, there's a preparation time. It's not just God's gonna show up tomorrow and give us all the answers and then we just go. No, there's boundaries around the mountain, keep your distance, And then God wants you to do something that shows that you've set apart this time and you've prepared yourself to pay attention. This is not a moment in history that you kind of just willy-nilly kind of want to space out and not be engaged. God is going to tell you something that's so important that God wants you to consecrate yourself, to set yourself aside, set aside the time, the place, the purpose, and even take a bath and wash your clothes. Like, show up ready. Like when you show up to a job interview, you want to dress the part. You want to make sure that you have ironed your blouse and you look prepared for what you're doing. That show up ready for God to tell you something that is monumentally important. Now, these people fled in the middle of the night out of fear of their lives, which is the clothes on their back that they've had on now for over a month. It's probably time to take a bath anyway. And they're asked to wash their clothes, to bathe, and to set apart time. They said, you have 3 days to get ready. And then when you're ready, when you're standing in the right place, your clothes are clean, your face is clean, you're prepared, you know it's a holy moment, then God will speak to us. When God knows that God has our full attention. Anyone who's ever tried to lead a class of children or speak in a crowded room, to get someone's attention to focus on something important you have to say, you often have to shout over the crowd, get the attention of the adults that are either chit-chatting or the children that are distracted, and have them focus on something really, really important to tell them. And God knows that this is the most important thing he's told to the people so far. So he says to Moses, they have to be ready. I'm giving you 3 days to make sure that they show up prepared to listen, and not just listen, but absorb what I'm saying and remember it so that they can then take action because of what I've said. We in modern culture are not as good at this. Because of technology, the ease of communication, we've actually become much worse at remembering and holding on to information in our minds rather than writing it down or seeing it written or like recording it and watching it again. For the people though, our faith ancestors at this time, the way they communicated was by retelling an oral narrative, a story that you would memorize verbatim so you could pass the information on correct to the next person. So they're used to hearing a message and then being responsible for memorizing the content of that message so that you can either obey it and or share it with other people. So Moses says that's what we're going to do. God is going to tell you something amazing. Get ready. When the people are ready, Moses approaches God and says, we're here. You know, we got ready. We brushed our hair. We brushed our teeth. We washed our faces. We earned our clean clothes. We're standing in the right place. We're here ready to receive this message. And it's then that God delivers what you and I now refer to as the Ten Commandments. If you read it in Hebrew scripture, if you were to read it in a synagogue, it's called the Ten Statements, just the ten basic sayings of God. Now these ten sayings or statements or commands, however we refer to them, have become the structure upon which many of us in the Judeo-Christian tradition have kind of molded our moral lives. And we kind of think of them as just always being around. People have always known this. But for Moses and those people listening, this was the first time they'd been given these boundaries. And we often think of the fact that if someone gives you rules or instructions or tells you this is the way we behave, that's kind of a reprimand. And even the Ten Commandments, many of them are delivered in the negative. You shall not do this, you shall not do that. And there are these boundaries around the people. But to live into these, Moses presents them to the people and realizes that these are not negative. These are not being delivered in a punitive sense. It's not that the people are already murdering or stealing or lying or coveting. These are rules, commands, boundaries of preparation to live into and understand that when we get to our new promised land, when 39 years from this moment you walk into that new land, you already know what it is to be a decent group of people. And decency, respect, awareness of others and their needs. If you look at the Ten Commandments, it's not just be a good person. It's not just kind of this command of like, hey, be nice to everybody. It's to be specific things of this is how we live as a community. You honor God, and there is only one true God. And you don't make any false idol for yourself or any representation of anything that could lead to you worshiping something that is other than the one true God. You honor the Sabbath. You take a day to rest. You honor your parents. In other words, the generations that came before you, they are not just old people who don't know anything anymore. No, they laid the groundwork for your community, your structure of life, your faith. Respect them. Honor your elders. Don't kill people. Don't steal from people. Don't commit adultery by betraying your spouse. Don't covet. Don't long for something someone else has to the point that you treat them poorly in order to hopefully get it for yourself. And these are put out there very specifically. Now, they result in you being a good person or a better person, but there's very specific rules here. And over time, these rules have not changed. As you read through scripture, you'll discover that actually Moses delivers these rules a second time to the people. And they don't change. And they haven't changed over generations of people living them out. The call is to be obedient to God with these boundaries around who we are. And the boundaries are not debatable. The way you live out these Ten Commandments may look different. So a very devout Orthodox Jew celebrates Sabbath from sundown on Friday to sundown on Saturday. That is just universally the way it's done. You or I might also keep a Sabbath, but maybe it's Wednesday. On Wednesday, we take it easy. We spend time with our family. You know, we relax. We indulge in the things that bring us satisfaction and joy. We're still being obedient to keeping the Sabbath holy, but it may not fall exactly on the same calendar day that someone else does it. When Scripture says to honor your father and mother, some people have awful parents, and it's hard to honor someone who has mistreated you or abused you or even abandoned you. But when you live into honoring the generation that came before you, that's something we can do. Honoring the people who built the community we live in, honoring those who led valiantly, maybe in a battle to defend who we are and the values we have, honoring people like teachers and mentors, people in our life who have influenced us, whether or not they are actually our mom and dad. So as we live into this, we're not breaking the rules, but we're understanding contextually that as these were delivered in the wilderness journey thousands of years ago, they may not play out the same way to our community today. Yet there are rules that apply to each person. The uniqueness of this is that other religious groups in the world in the time of Moses through today have deities, have rules that how their religious institution. This is the way we do it. This is how you identify that we are a believer in this God or those gods. And often, more often than not, those rules have to do directly with the individual worshiper's relationship with God. If you disobey God, God will be mad and God will punish you. If you do something that is outside the boundaries, God will be mad with you and you'll lose your favor with God. And you always live in this fear that if I step outside the bounds, God's wrath will come upon me. The uniqueness about the Ten Commandments is, it's not just about your relationship with God, which thankfully is presented in a positive way. There is one God, and that God wants to be in relationship with you and doesn't want you to be distracted by any other thing that you can worship. But more than your relationship with God, there are more commands out of those 10 that have to do with your relationship to other people. So it's unique in the religious history of the world that these 10 commandments include commands about how you are to treat other people. That does not happen in any other faith. That makes this so unique. Don't kill other people. Don't steal from other people. Don't lie or give false testimony about other people. Don't covet what other people have. These boundaries about how to treat your neighbor are unique to these commands that God gives through Moses. And the people took notice of that. And it's a hard change to make. They've lived their whole lives being oppressed by people who worshiped a multitude of gods and who lived their life to appease those gods because out of fear, if we don't please the gods, something negative will happen in our lives. And nothing about the faith of the Egyptians that the Israelites witnessed during slavery had to do with how to treat others. It certainly didn't because they treated the Israelites very poorly. So their religion did not teach, treat other people with respect or dignity, or that they have some worth in the eyes of our Creator. No, it was treat other people so that they can benefit you, so you have more offerings to appease your gods. This is a different way of thinking and being, culturally and religiously and interpersonally. And now Moses has quite a task on his hands. He's going to have almost 4 decades to help mold the people into a people who live in to these Ten Commandments, into a people who, when they arrive in the Promised Land, they actually are living this out. They're actually treating other people with dignity and respect, and then living into this for generations after. Now, we as Christians know that Jesus taught the same commandments. He got a little bit more concise in what you now refer to as the Golden Rule, this teaching of loving God and loving your neighbor as yourself. But again, even if you condense the Ten Commandments into the Golden Rule, it's about your relationship with God. Love God. And your relationship with others, love your neighbor as yourself. There's no statement in the Ten Commandments or in Jesus' teaching about how to treat yourself. It's uniquely always focused on your relationship with God and your relationship with others. And if every person obeys, then everyone is mutually benefited. If everyone is loving God and honoring God, then we're living into what God wants for us. And if everyone is loving their neighbor, then you too are being loved because everyone else is loving you. Where the struggle often comes in obeying the Ten Commandments or the Golden Rule is when you're interacting with people who don't follow these rules. When you interact with people who have no understanding, appreciation, or obedience to loving God and loving others, they often treat you poorly. And that feels awful. And it makes it harder to love them back because they're being jerks. And when we live in a world where not everyone is aware of or obedient to these commands, it does cause chaos and sin and betrayal and hardship and oppression and all the things we play out and we see play out when people act in ways that are evil and self-centered. As I've been working in my own life as a parent to coach my daughter in her faith journey, I had this wonderful aha moment this past summer where Natalie and I were somewhere that was very crowded in an amusement park, and there was a crowd rushing, a crowd of adults rushing to be the first people to get in line somewhere. And I had a proud mommy moment as my daughter stepped aside and basically said, let them go ahead, they're sinning. Let this let them go. They're being jerks. They said, me first. And just knock everybody else out of the way. Knock the people over with the strollers and the, you know, coffees in their hands, all that. I want to be first. It's about me. And these weren't 8-year-olds. These were 20-something-year-olds. These are people who should know as adults how to interact with other people in a crowded space. And they were blinded by their own desire to satisfy their own immediate needs and push everybody out of the way. That is in direct opposition to these commands. If you're loving God and loving others, and everything you do in your life is about there's only one God, and I'm going to respect the dignity, value, and life of others, that is wonderful. You treat everyone else very well. And if they also are doing the same thing, you will be treated very well. You will receive respect, acknowledgement of your human worth and dignity. You'll respect others, and they will respect you. But it breaks down when we encounter others who do not have this level of obedience to God's commands. And that's where we as Christians find these points of evangelism, this point of outreach, this point of education, and saying, I, as a disciple, not only of the one true God of Israel, but also of his son, Jesus Christ, have been taught that I'm to honor God and honor everyone else. Everyone is my neighbor. And if I do that, I'm putting out this amazing respect and interaction and a social life that makes it attractive to other people. They want to be around me because if I live like this, it's a pleasant interaction. We might always agree, but we're not going to be nasty to each other. But it's difficult when the predominant people you encounter are not giving that back to you. And that's where we find ourselves at this evangelistic moment of how do I share the good news with people who maybe don't know it or don't understand it or desire to live in a way that's different, that's more self-centered than other and God-centered, and how do I bridge that gap? Moses was wrestling with that.
He had people that were infantile in their faith, unexposed, ignorant, not well-versed yet in who God was. And understandably, in a panic, being forcibly moved from the life that had been familiar to them for over 400 years, and having to fend for themselves, and they were panicked. They're grumbling, they're complaining, their annoyances came out of this fear that we are not going to be able to survive out here. And once God provided for their basic needs, food, water, and safety, now they find themselves open to this understanding of, wow, the God who provided what I needed to just stay alive, I'll now listen to that God. And that God has told me to move forward and to continue in this right relationship with God, to have my needs met, my basic needs. I now need to live in community and acknowledge that other people might have needs too. And that I should acknowledge that and maybe take care of them or receive kindness and outreach and care from them. And how this interpersonal way of being a community that together worships the one true God is mutually beneficial to everyone. And that sounds really obvious and simple. If I have a sandwich and you have no sandwich, I should give you half of mine. This is a really basic kind of kindergarten skill. But unfortunately, because of the brokenness of the world and the presence of sin, we know that many adults don't live into that common sense reaction. If you have too much and someone has too little, you should share. If you are encountering someone in need, you should see if you can help them. And you should be open to receiving help from others. All of this seems kind of like common sense. Because of our sinful nature and our brokenness, we kind of fall back into that trap that the Israelites did. Or this fear of, I'm not going to have enough, so I should hoard all that I have. Or this fear if I help someone else, they may betray me or hurt me, or they may be lying to me. Or this fear, if I give to someone else, I'll become a doormat and just walk over me and take advantage of me all the time. And that can happen when you interact with individuals who are not following the same boundaries that you are. So when we and brothers and sisters in Christ interact with each other, it's often mutually this thing, idea of acceptance and equity and treatment of give and take. And then we wrestle with that encounter when it's not balanced. So I would encourage you this Lenten season, as you're reading through Exodus with me and kind of looking at what Moses is trying to deal with these people just figuring out for the first time what it is to be obedient to God and to live lives that show gratitude for what God has provided by showing respect to others, to kind of be aware between now and Holy Week of the times you encounter people who are not living like this, the times you encounter people who are so self-centered and so self-absorbed and maybe so afraid that they're unable to interact with you as a neighbor. They're unable to interact with you in a way that shows respect and dignity. And to kind of self-identify how that makes you feel. And how maybe in your prayer life and study, you can be more aware of how best to respond. To plant the seeds, to offer an example of a better, more obedient behavior that honors God and that honors neighbors and allows us to live into this call to be a people who are consecrated, set apart, because we know the way we are called to live is different than the way many people do. Amen. To respond to the needs of our world, I want to acknowledge to you that our congregation has joyfully and very eagerly donated $500 out of our mission fund to the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance Group that is directly working in Ukraine with our Christian partners of churches there, receiving refugees, providing food, medicine, shelter, and opportunities to then kind of redirect refugees to safer locations. So thank you. We had enough money just sitting in our mission account to make the decision recently to send that $500, and we will continue to monitor that situation to see if other financial response is required. I also wanna share with you that we heard from our friends over at Carmel School in India just yesterday, and that they've reopened the school, and maybe to the children's dismay, they're gonna make up all the standardized tests they missed for the last 2 years of COVID shutdown. So the 10th, 11th, and 12th standards or grades there are gonna be engaging in standardized tests coming up to catch up for 2 years of the disruption of their school year, but they are actually filled with joy to be back in school, to be back in fellowship with one another, and to be able to thankfully feel that some normalcy is returning to their lives. So thank you for those of you who do sponsor students at Carmel School and continue to support them. They do send their well wishes to us and thank us so much for our continued interaction with them. Please join me in prayer. Almighty God, we thank you that we're able to respond to needs here in our immediate community and around the world. We thank you for the amazing benevolence and generosity and financial stewardship that allows our mission committee to support those in Ukraine. We thank you for those who sponsor the students at Carmel School that allow them to be educated and to engage in a community that supports them and teaches them about the love of Christ. We ask, Lord, that you continue to guide us so that we can be good stewards of all the gifts we have, not only our time, talents, and money, but also our conversations as we share with others and celebrate the work that we are doing in the name of Christ through this congregation. Guide us, Lord, to give thanks to you and to understand that out of our abundance, we can truly show love for our neighbors. We ask this all, giving thanks in the name of Christ. For who had knee surgery that same week as Jenny. I saw her on Friday, and I saw her walk up 6 steps, so she's making good progress too as people live into these new knees they have. I also want to lift up a new prayer concern I have. Russell and I have a close friend named Kyle who is in the ICU, and we ask for your prayers for him as he seeks to recover and hopefully wake up soon. Are there other requests this morning for prayers or updates we'd like to offer? Yes, Robin.
People in Ukraine and around the world. Yes. For peace.
Continue prayers for Ukraine. I know many of you have been up the street to either St. Michael or the Ukrainian Center or Manor College to show your support at their different fundraisers and resource drives that they've had. So thank you. Yes.
And the Habero officer.
Yes. Continue prayers
for wife and children and.
Yes. Continue prayers for the Habero police officer who's now home on his hospice care. Yes, Betsy.
Thank you for the prayers for my son Matthew. He is at home after 5 days in the hospital and will be getting epidurals and hopefully not surgery.
All right, continued prayers for Betsy's son Matthew that the epidurals and other treatment at home will help him avoid surgery as he seeks to have his issues with his back resolved. Please join me in prayer. Creator God, we are just overwhelmed by your desire to love us and be in relationship with us. We thank you that scripture points to your desire to directly speak to us, each one as individuals, to set us apart as a holy people, and to call us to something that demands we show the same love for others that you have shown to us.
Creator God, we know that we are people who are sinful. It's only through your grace that we receive the gift of salvation. We thank you for that grace, especially at times when we definitely do not deserve it. And Lord, as we live in a world that is broken, that is at war, a world that is argumentative and seems to be just looking for things to complain about, we are reminded, Lord, of the way you interacted with your holy people during their time in the wilderness, the way you provided and showed love and patience, the way you set up boundaries to guide the people to make a better life for themselves in relationship to you and especially in relationship with one another. Lord, we ask your continued guidance so that we can be better neighbors, so that we can respond in ways that show love and affirm the dignity of each person. We ask, Lord, that through your Spirit's presence, you bring us comfort and guidance. You bring healing to those who continue to desire recovery for their physical bodies and their mental well-being. Lord, we lift up to you those who are struggling. And we ask, Lord, that give us opportunities to respond and show your love to others. Lord, we especially lift up those who are seeking refuge from war. We ask, Lord, that you bring peace to our world and wisdom to our leaders. Guide us, Lord, to respond in ways that are appropriate so that we can really feel that we are having a positive impact. Lord, we thank you for the ministry, mission, and outreach of this congregation. We thank you for our opportunities to gather here in person and online for worship and study. We thank you for the addition now of fellowship opportunities and more mission and outreach and children's programming. And Lord, as the world wakes up for the spring season, as we prepare to fill our calendar, Lord, do not let us be overwhelmed. Let us make decisions that honor you and honor our neighbors, that allow us to use our time and talents and energy in ways that bring glory to you and satisfaction to ourselves. Continue to guide us to be good disciples, to respond to others, to show them love, and to help teach others not only what you command, but what you desire of us, so that all we do can bring glory to you. We ask this all as those you've taught to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you, as we close our time of worship this morning, to stand with me to sing our two closing hymns.
Thank you.
morning as we embrace the fact that we are in the middle, the midpoint of our Lenten journey, as we can look back and see that we've been preparing for 3 weeks, and then we have 3 weeks yet to prepare, to get ourselves ready, to acknowledge the need we have for a Savior, and to welcome triumphantly Jesus Christ truly as Savior to all, we understand that we've been preparing for much more than just a few weeks. That God has been preparing the people of God, you and I, all the way back to the time of the journey in the wilderness to say, as individuals, you need some boundaries. You need to be in right relationship with God and with one another. And when you set yourself apart and acknowledge your relationship with God and with others, it's then that you can truly be prepared for God to use you to truly be that light in the darkness for all God's people. Go now with the blessings of God, our Creator, Jesus, our Messiah, and the knowledge of the ever-present, ever-comforting Holy Spirit. Amen.